Hi, Milos. Thank you very much for talking to us today. You are one of the experts who actually looked at the original Latin work of Willis, and not many of us can say that. So why do you think Willis was publishing in Latin?
We cannot know for sure, but most probably because everybody else was writing anatomy and medicine in Latin at that time, and he wanted to be heard and understood on continent, not just in London or Oxford. So everybody at that time, everybody was writing serious things in Latin. That was
so eight of his books were published in Latin, but the last one is in English. The plan and easy method of preserving those that are well.
Okay. Because that was like for general audience and with clinical. Some of things he did was, let's say, very simplified for science, and some for his practice, because he was also practicing physician and eager to make money. So some of these things let's say, from more pragmatical point of view. But all these, which are really important today concerning anatomy, physiology, medicine, and so basically Latin.
So basically this last work was basically a manual for doctors, prescriptions, and probably it was also published posthumously. So he didn't even intend to publish it.
This guy who very soon it was translated, everything was translated in English with a writer from London who was not a medical doctor, but like a virtuoso or guy of general culture. He was called Samuel, I think Pordage is right pronunciation, I'm not sure. And he translated everything, but started with first what he translated was Dr. Willis' practice of physics. So it was exactly recipes and many things which we today not regard very well, because it was a typical clinical medicine or recipes of that time. And it is, you can imagine that it is not like modern medicine. So it's the least important part of Willis' work, but at that time it was most interesting because it was about therapy and such approaches. So that was probably another reason why Willis didn't wrote much in English, because very soon there was translation. Okay, significant part of this translation was after Willis died, in just few years. From 1681 to 1685, everything was translated.
So you read the original Latin and you also read the translation. Yeah. So what is your impression about the accuracy of the translation? Do you think it was well done or?
Well, a translation is, how to say, it is accurate because there are no missing parts. And so, but problem is that this guy was not medical doctor. And he lived, this is 1681 English. So I feel that for medical doctor or scientist today, knowing all terminology which we like, we still say medulla oblongata or cerebral cortex or corpus striatum. And when you see it in Latin, you immediately recognize it. But when you see it in this English translation, you have problem. It's like reading Shakespeare in original. This is not English of today. So maybe it's even easier. I will give you a few examples. Let's say, and why it is important, because when you read any book of history of neuroscience or anatomy, you will often see that Willis was first to describe this or that. And he was, and introduced terms, like, for example, for striate bodies or corpus striatum. And this guy translated, I have this modern reprint, which is almost the only one. It was all translated in English, but subsequently reprinted only in 20th century and only Anatomy of the Brain. That's what most readers know today. And first problem, original Latin is 29 chapters because it's Anatomy of the Brain and of the nerves, the whole peripheral nervous system. This is always only first 20 chapters because it's brain. And 21 to 29 is missing. So even today, you will have to find this Samuel Portage from 17th century in your Oxford library to see the rest in English. But when you look this example in this modern thing. On page 16, just two examples for terminology and everything is clear. For striate bodies, this guy said that it is chamfered or streaked bodies. I hope I'm pronouncing correctly. C-H-M-F-E-R-E-D. In every history of neuroanatomy, you will see this, that Willis called, first described striate bodies and called it chamfered bodies because they look in English this. But if you look the same page I printed out from Latin, says post hec corpora striata medulla oblongata. So he clearly called it corpus striatum. And if you look Latin, you immediately know that he is talking about this. Then, for example, in description of figures and in text, there will be something called the tunnel or tunnel, like a tunnel. And when you look original, it is called infundibulum. So this is infundibulum from hypothalamus to hypophysis. Okay, Gaia, this portage again translated, so to speak, correctly, because it's like a funnel or tunnel or something like this. But when you read all this in English, you are in big trouble. You know, you can, if you read carefully and you are good anatomist and then you look at the pictures, oh, that's infundibulum. You can reconstruct a lot of this.
Because we still use the same.
Let's see it.
Because we still use the same terminology today. And
because we use Latin in English or in any other language.
So what are the main terms that we still use today, which were given by Willis?
Corpus striatum is one of them. Most of those which we really use today and he used were not his invention except for corpus striatum because most of these terms, let's say superior or inferior colliculi, you know. He said testes and natus, like buttocks and testicles, and it was very usual at that time, so it is obsolete. He was one of the first to call this way, but there will be not many original terms which we keep in official nomen anatomica today, except corpus striatum and, of course, circle of Willis, which we call after him. He just described the vessels.
How about accessory nerve?
Nervus accessorius, of course.
That is Willis.
For this, it will not exactly overlap our current anatomical description because we knew after histology, we knew a few more details, but basically that something comes from the spinal cord and joints, that's really success. And then what was called grand sympathicus, like, you know, we use completely different terminology today, but Willis was one of the, he said intercostal nerve, nervus intercostalis, but it is not the same as today intercostal nerves. It was a large sympathetic trunk. So it was very important discovery of his and laid for almost 100 years unnoticed in the net because partly of this terminology and because he was, like in many things, precautious. You know, only in 18th century, Winslow and some others really discussed. So it was a really important topic for 18th century neurophysiology, this intercostal nerve and sympathies and autonomic nervous system.
Right. So basically, the paravertebral sympathetic chain.
Sympathetic chain, paravertebral, and some other things which are to guts and everything. So he described it really well, but under this at that time normal, but today obscure term, intercostal nerve.
In fact, he also ligated the vagus nerve. He ligated the vagus nerve and he looked at the effect on the heartbeat.
So, for vagus, for example, in his original Latin, it is called vagus. But in this Portuguese translation, it's wandering. Okay, that's correct. Again, so Gaio was translating quite correctly, but he tried to say everything in English, not Latin English, but English. So this is wandering nerve, and it is a correct translation of vagus, nerve who wanders about through intestine. But again, it is easy case because we all know that from 19th century it was wandering nerve or wanderer in German. So you or pathetic for trochlearis. There are things which are easy, but there are many, many things, especially when you come to smaller details that are in English. If you are a neuroanatomist and you read carefully and compare with pictures, you will reconstruct 99% of this. But you will it will require concentration, focus, and effort. And if you are just ordinary medical doctor or even biologist or whatever, without special anatomy training. When you see Latin, you just read and see what you see in modern textbooks, corpus striatum, or stria terminalis, or colliculi, or infundibulum, or something like this. So that's why I think original Latin should be recovered from the dust and also translated in modern English, so to speak, so that we can easily understand each other.
So do you think that the translation of Samuel Pardich in 1681 and 85 is almost hindered how Willis is perceived today?
It could, for anatomy itself, because, you and I are anatomists and we are like a small tribe.
Probably the anatomists of the time of Willis, they all spoke Latin. This is how they communicate.
But for them, probably it was not because they probably didn't read like Zomering or whoever followed or Vilsen. They didn't read Portage. They just read Willis in Latin because there were several editions of his Opera Omnia. Collected works. And all these, I have also these editions, and these are all in Latin. He was reprinted, 10 times or even more in different large collections like Mangetus and others. So throughout the continent, he was available in Latin. And yes. Nobody had problem with this. Only we, modern readers, who are out of the Latin tradition and just everybody reads English. And it's not a problem of the reader, it's a problem of those who reprinted. That was very nice and okay to reprint this anatomy of the brain in 20th century. But it was not big service to wide audience. Because for wide audience, when you read all this, it's like reading, John Donne or Chaucer or somebody, It's weird English from the, I think even for those who are native English speakers in Great Britain, United Kingdom today, it's not easy task.
So Milos, do you, is this your mission now to kind of produce a new modern translation using today's nomenclature for these works? Is this what you're working on?
I'm doing this ex privata diligencia, what I did for three main things, which is anatomy of the brain, then the soul of the brutes or animals,
anima brutorum,
and what is usually forgotten, before that he published two short treatises. It is called Diatribe Due, a very peculiar term for treatises at that time. But if you really want to understand his physiology, because he was one of the first to apply like Paracelsian and other, at that time, modern chemistry based on sulfur or, you know, sulfurous ignition of the nerve impulse and such things. So it's very prominent, it's his thinking on all physiology. And it was basically in these small two treatises first developed and just applied in anatomy and this. And the soul of animals is important because it contains a lot of comparative anatomy, which was also in the first book partly, but extended and elaborated in this one. And also then comparative, you may say, we usually say that comparative psychology or ethology started with Darwin and Morgan and some other people in 19th century. But basically, if you look this Anima Brutorum, he was the first comparative psychologist for many, not just even insects. It is very rarely mentioned that he also was one of basically the founder of real comparative, how to call it, behavioral studies, not just comparative neuroanatomy, but comparative psychology or...
Yes, he based his argument that the seat for higher cognitive functions lie in the cerebral cortex on two arguments. One of them was comparative anatomy that showed that the cerebral cortex is the largest in the animal kingdom in human. That was one, number one. And the second was that he dissected his patients, and when they had neurological problems, like signs of intractable epilepsy or learning disabilities, then he noticed that there was a anatomical abnormality in the folding of the cerebral cortex. So basically, based on these two arguments, he suggested that it must be the cerebral cortex which is making us human. And the higher cognitive
function. But for most of the examples and material for this is in the third book, Pathology of the Brain, which is also, Portage translated this too, but you can imagine that if you have problems in terminology with anatomy, how much it would be with neurology and psychiatry. Okay, he was the first to introduce the term neurology. Pathology was by Jean Fernel before. But again, I think it's, if not the first, one of the first books or monographs which is just on brain pathology. That's also, that's even bigger than this. And just to add, the third source for the cortex as a seat was exactly in this, his chemical theories, because he described briefly in Anatomy of the Brain, but in these previous two studies, how all these sulfurous and phosphorus compounds, it's like a general term at that time for, it's probably not correct, but we today say ATP and such things, you know, or sodium potassium pump and such things. But when you just put X by, you know, algebra, not real data, then he was talking very about very similar things, only calling it sulfur or phosphorus or something. So he thought also that in the cortex itself, it's the like chemical factory for these processes fueling the nerve impulse. So even in this sense, it was like a third clinical argument, comparative anatomical, and also physiological.
So
why also these two studies should be, let's say, translated or revived.
What was your biggest surprise when you started comparing these the English translation?
My biggest surprise for me, you know, I'm collecting all this historical stuff itself. So for me, the biggest surprise, because I was like almost everybody else, my first introduction or contact with Willis was this English reprint from 20th century from the Portage. And then I thought, okay, Willis is a nice guy, he described, but he was complex and weird, you know, looking at this English, not very clear descriptions and so on. And then I finally get Latin, and then I see, wait a minute, this guy described everything clearly, because you know, when you see infundibulum, corpus striatum, corpus pineale, and then you immediately recognize all these terms, you don't have cognitive effort and troubles. What was the intention of the writer? Is it correct description? You immediately see. So that was probably my biggest surprise. Okay, I need to read the Latin, not English, because after all, the guy himself wrote everything in Latin. His translator is responsible for our current problems. Although I must say again, when you look at 17th century, this translation is quite accurate. The problem is only the Portage wanted everything in English, not anglicized Latin, but English. And he did it. And now you have a problem 300 years later with this English, not with Latin.
So if you look at the text and also you look at the figures, so it's interesting that the figures must have come from different artists or different illustrators, because some have slightly different style. So for instance, if you look at the style used for the abstract drawing of the autonomous nervous system, that was very different from the drawings of Wren for the sheep and the human brain. So do we know anything who did the illustrations in these?
I'm not sure. I mean, usually it is stated that Christopher Wren did most of this, but Richard Lower was also there, and then Willis himself. So I would say my impression is that Richard Lower did a lot of these sections with him, maybe even more than Willis himself, because, you know, Willis was a polymath, a practicing doctor, a little bit politician, so he did many things. And Richard Lover seems, when you read all this data, like really surgeon anatomist, working. So maybe half of the sections and even drawings are basically from him.
Anthony Wood, you know, the historian who was neighbor of Willis in now what is called Merton Street. Anthony Wood, he wasn't loved by anybody. He had always had some bad stories of everybody. And that's exactly what he wrote. That Willis is taking too much credit, but some of the credit should really go for the students. But that's not true that Willis didn't give credit to the students, because if you read all the books,
he has foreword, he has very thanks very much for Richard Lower. No, I would not agree.
And Christopher Wren is always mentioned in the.
Yes. No, I didn't want it at all. He was not, he was quite fair, and they were like a small team. You know, even William Harvey came at few moments there. So he was not trying to take credit from them. I'm just saying that it's probable that many of these dissections and even these drawings are from, let's say, Richard Lower. He's like the best candidate. Without trying to diminish any role of Willis, he certainly did a lot of the sections. I'm just looking from, let's say, very pragmatic point of view. Lower is at that moment less famous than Willis, and he is really not dealing with many patients. He's just dissecting. So he has a lot more time to do this. And Willis has to ride on horse to visit a wealthy, you know, his therapies probably were, that's also paradoxical. When you look his physiology and anatomy, he's like a revolutionary progressive, seeing the future. And when you look his clinical practice, it's very ordinary 16th, 17th century clinical practice, which is horrible from today's point of view. Bloodletting, all kinds of decoctions. So
Like,
I don't know how
dried scorpion and mix it with dried dog excrement and make it and put it to the eye. So when you read the original letters, you know, there are some shocking therapies. But probably Willis was looking for the rational explanations of these diseases.
He was.
Excellent descriptions.
Look, his recipes or descriptions are not, it's very typical when you read others, let's say, from Avicenna onwards, it didn't change in 300 years. Even Vesalius, when you look his surgery, and he was also a clinician, not just an anatomist, Vesal. And he has the same recipe. So it was normal until 19th century, it was like clinical medicine and pharmacy. There was so prominent role in all these excrements, which we today maybe find like horrible, but then it was normal and usual stuff. So he is, in this sense, he is quite conservative. When you look this pharmaceutica, but it is called rational pharmacy, pharmaceutica rationalis, because he really tried to find, I would say he was not really trying to explain the mechanism of working of drugs, but consequences. He was interested in physiological effects of these drugs on brain function. So what was rational is this, not how to select the proper drug and what is, I don't know, chemical composition, but how to, of all this stuff, how to select one which will have clear functional consequences. He was always very minded about cause and effect. So he was not really trying to revise pharmacy, but just using all these pharmaceuticals samples to rewrite or reconceptualize physiology. That's my impression when I read all this. So it was very, maybe it was not very rational from our point of view, but it was striving to be rational, and it was his major obsession all the times. But I would say that when we come to pharmacology, that's not really his contribution. Physiology or pathology.
Thank you very much, Milos, and we wish you all the best with the translations.